The lunch was great, and there's no better day than today, Republic Day, to talk about this very important subject at hand. It's an unusual story, it's an unusual subject for the Jaipur Literature Festival, but I hope that we're all breaking new ground with the Swachh Bharat movement that has been launched by Prime Minister Narendra Modi about 3 years ago now. But let me introduce to you my panel. Hema Maira Gupta works with the American School in New Delhi. She's an educator. Most importantly, Hema and me have been, we grew up together right here in Jaipur. We went to the MGD Girls School together. Right. Angela Saini, who is a science journalist with the BBC in London. Angela has written a book on women in science, which has just come out and which will be featured here at the JLF. But her next book, which is what I'd like to focus on, is about race and caste. And I'm hoping that we can talk much more about all the aspects of Swachh Bharat, not just cleaning India, jhadu poche se, but also in its many manifestations of pollution, including caste pollution. And I'd like to ask Angela about that. Gurcharan Das, a very well-known writer, has written several books on several issues, needs no introduction. Uday Mahurkar works with the India Today magazine, has been in Gujarat for many years, is now in New Delhi, and has interviewed Prime Minister Narendra Modi several times, especially when he was Chief Minister of Gujarat, and has also asked him about these issues. And Jeffrey Gettleman, the South Asia Bureau Chief of the New York Times, based in Delhi, and you've also written a few stories about this, especially your story on toilet, on the movie Toilet, which I thought was quite interesting. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, let me just put a few facts about the Swachh Bharat movement that we have, that we are in the midst of, and then we'll start our discussion. Now, so this was Prime Minister Narendra Modi's first independence. That's Nawazuddin Siddiqui, by the way, in the front lawns. But we are going to valiantly carry on, and I hope all of you are going to be focused on Swachh Bharat and making India clean.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Very good.
Okay. So, Prime Minister Narendra Modi's first Independence Day speech from the ramparts of the Red Fort, which is in 2014, and when he announces this major mission called the Swachh Bharat Mission. And one of the aspects that he talks about, and remember, it was Mahatma Gandhi who talked about how cleanliness is next to godliness. That's just one of the phrases that we've grown up with. So what's happened in the last 3 years? Let's look at some of these statistics. 25,000 change leaders mobilized. 100% household awareness for hand washing at critical times. And we know that the oftener you wash your hands, the less susceptible you are to disease. So that's a huge achievement, 100% household awareness. And Amitabh Bachchan, has he gone? Has contributed to some of that awareness. 75% of 200 villages declared open defecation free. That's, if that statistic is true, I think it's a big one. But according to UNICEF, around 564 million Indians, which is just under half the population, still defecate in the open, in fields, forests, next to ponds, along highway medians, and on the beach. Government of India officials say they have spent more than $4 billion to help install 50 million toilets so far, building community latrines and providing subsidies. And if you look at the website of the government, there is so if villages do well on this parameter, which is to eliminate open defecation, you are given an ODF, which is an open defecation free status. So I'm going to now just begin this conversation by asking Angela, would you like to launch this by telling us? Okay, so you don't live in India anymore, do you?
No.
When you come from London or wherever you're based, and you come to Delhi and to Jaipur, what's your first impression about the Swachh Bharat?
Well,
Well, I think every country has their own issues when it comes to you know, public spaces. How do we keep our environments clean? How do we keep ourselves tidy? Now, in London, much of the responsibility for communal, you know, so out in the streets, as soon as you leave your house, a lot of the responsibility for that is given to the government. So very rarely will you see anyone sweeping the area outside their house. It really never happens. By contrast, my sister lives in Germany. Her husband is German. And over there, there's a very strong civic sense that, you know, every space and every environment is a shared environment. Everybody tidies up after themselves. There's very high rates of recycling, for instance. A very strong civic sense that we keep our shared environment clean and it's all our responsibility.
Can I just pick up on that, Angela, and ask you, Gurcharan? Angela talks about how in England and in several other parts of the world, not just in the West, but in you see this when you travel all across Southeast Asia, for example. Even poor countries like Laos and Cambodia are clean. They're clean people. They pick up after themselves. They don't litter wherever they go. So what is it about us in India that, you know, we hum jo ghar ka jo kooda hai usko ghar to saaf rakhte hai lekin koode ko hum bahar fek dete. So what is this? Why can't we keep our homes and families litter free?
You know, it's interesting you mentioned Southeast Asia, because a few years ago I was privileged to meet Lee Kuan Yew.
Right.
And
who was then Prime Minister of Singapore.
And he reminded me how dirty Singapore was in the 1960s. And he said that the two greatest achievements that he was proudest of, going from a third world country to a first world country in one generation, was one, the drive to cleanliness and to clean up Singapore. And why? Because he said he created citizens from individuals, that when individuals take ownership of the public space, they become citizens. And so, let me complete the second point he made, which was that he said that the second achievement was very counterintuitive, and that is that he made a foreign language the national language of Singapore. In other words, there were three communities, Chinese, Malay, and Indians. And he said none of their languages would be the national language. It would be English, because he wanted to create one community.
Are you saying that India is a collection of communities? We are not a one language people, and therefore we are not a clean people? Jeffrey, you have
I'm not saying that at all. I think the point he was making is a very profound point.
Yes.
That that civic virtue doesn't come naturally to human beings. We think of ourselves first. We don't think of the public space. And the word civic, you know, in ancient, it's a word from ancient Greece. And it means it's related to city and civility. And it's the idea of taking ownership of the public space, that it's mine. And my horizon of concern should extend beyond where my door ends. And it should go beyond, even if every Indian family, instead of washing our
so why
house,
is it no the question is why is it that we don't do that? That's the question.
Just one second.
Okay.
So if we raised our circle of concern and went 1 meter outside our front door and cleaned the passageway, if you live in an apartment, or the road, or the footpath outside our house, India would become clean.
Okay, so I'm going to, I think, make this a much more interactive session. So let me ask you, do you think that Indians are not interested in keeping their neighborhoods clean? What do you think? Okay. So no, the question is, it's a yes and no answer. Are we a clean people? No. Okay. And now the next question, why are we not a clean people? Yes, go ahead. Give me an answer. Okay, you don't have a mic. Caste. Discrimination, okay? Anyone else? Yes, come on. All right.
Let me make a controversial point to your question, Jyoti ji.
Ji.
I think one of the things is that we had a heritage of Mohenjo-daro and Harappa.
Okay.
And some, and we had cities. And somewhere I think that consciousness, that heritage got lost.
All right.
And therefore we don't have that consciousness.
Okay. You know, I disagree with all these people. Okay. I'll tell you very honestly.
Okay.
The same Indians who throw the garbage outside, as soon as they cross, 8 hours later, you arrive in London, you cross the immigration line at Heathrow, and after you go out the airport, you don't throw things out the window. You pay your taxes. You don't stop at red light.
Okay.
It's got nothing to do with culture.
Culture changes
in 8 hours.
Right.
How does culture change in 8 hours?
Uday, would you like to, you'd like to come
you see,
in here?
I mean, of course, what he's saying, I totally agree, you know. But now, you see, what is the way forward? Mm-hmm. I had the occasion to speak to the Prime Minister at least on 3 occasions on this. He said, I have given an idea to the country.
You've spoken to the Prime Minister on Swachh Bharat on three occasions.
Thrice.
Yeah. What did he say?
On the very day he made the announcement, on
the
evening also, you know. He said, I have given an idea. And now people, it's an idea to change the mindset of the people, you know. Mm-hmm. And now people, government, entrepreneurs, all have to come together to take it forward, you know. And you will see that after 3 years, I think there are at least 500 startups, as I understand, which have got into the area of cleaning India, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are new companies.
So you think this is the seed that the Prime Minister has laid of this movement?
No, but he's also
got
a plan.
He's
also got a plan, which I think not many are aware here.
Uh-huh.
First 18 months was specially reserved for spreading awareness. And now he has started implementing it from the government side.
Okay.
You know,
Jesse,
and about 5 lakh about toilets have been made in schools because his experience in Gujarat was that the girl dropout from schools was because there was no separate toilet for the girls.
That's a very important
point. So 5 lakh
and we know
toilets have been
true,
made.
Yeah.
I mean, if we go by, if you keep an error margin, I think it's a very big figure.
Yes, absolutely. That's a huge figure.
And the challenge ahead is, you know, see, I see that cleaning rivers, Namami Gange is one, you know. Every urban center has a river which is so dirty.
Hmm.
I mean, you can't think as to how people or the government will be able to clean it, you know. So I think there is a strategy needed for cleaning up the rivers which are passing through urban centers.
And the people must get much more involved with the government in doing that.
People
but
and
Jesse,
the government
let me
also.
Let me ask you. Yeah.
Now so municipalities come, you know.
Right.
Municipalities, you know, municipalities in India is a very weak arm of Indian governance, you know.
Sure.
So how do you
involve
them
make
to
that.
Meet this challenge?
Right. So Jeffrey, let me ask you. You've just come to India a few months ago, and you lived in Africa for some years. So can you give us the African experience? Gurcharan talks about how Indians, when they take an 8-hour flight to wherever it is in Western Europe, immediately start following the rules. But what about in Africa, where probably India is as poor, if not poorer, than several parts of Africa are poorer, but cleaner, would you say?
Well, it's a really good question, and my wife and I just moved to India a few months ago, and we have had an amazing experience and felt a lot of warmth and welcome from every place where we've turned. So I don't, you know, I'm not super qualified to kind of weigh in on big India issues, but as far as Africa, it's many of the same problems. It's a rapid urbanization. It's fast population growth. If you look at the two graphs of the population projections for India and Africa, they're very similar. It's almost like a straight line going up over the next 30 or 40 years. And India is soon going to pass China as the most populous country in the world. In a few years, India is going to be the most populous country in the world. And I see so many of these issues connected to population, and I just don't hear a lot of people talking about population. Some of the things that I've covered just in the first few months was those hospital deaths in Gorakhpur, this toilet movie, and pollution, which I've written several stories about, you know, really bad air pollution in New Delhi. The root of all these issues is a huge, fast-growing population, and I don't know how you're ever going to get in front of the sanitation issues at the rate that the population is growing. It's just going to be very, very difficult.
So how is it that Africa is able to be much more cleaner, although there's several parts of Africa
it's
much
not,
poorer?
It's not. If you go into these rapidly changing urban areas, in Kenya, for instance, in Nairobi, you see garbage everywhere.
Okay.
Plastic bags, plastic bottles, it's the same problem. And I think it's going to be very difficult to make progress on it without having a bigger conversation about resources and the number of people you're trying to help.
Hema,
can you respond?
Yes, absolutely. I'd like you to come in here.
So, you know, as an educator, you know, I've been a teacher for like 34 years, and I feel that, yes, population is, of course, a huge problem, and resources are finite. But I want to really focus on the individual responsibility part of it. And my son, who's 28 today, when he was young and at the Sriram School in Delhi, there was a big issue with the burning of crackers over Diwali. And these little kids were told at school, you know what, this is not a good thing for child labor and air pollution and noise pollution. And the same kids that would tell their parents and say, you know, I want to buy more of this and more of that, suddenly came back, and my son says to me, but my teacher has said that for the logical reasons.
Okay, that was drowning out in about the city.
But it was the same kids who then took responsibility and said, you know, I don't want any more crackers.
Yeah? Better?
Better, yeah. Okay. So I think one is we have to inculcate in young kids from early on and explain to them the importance of hygiene, pollution, etc., etc.
So that's one way, is to start them young.
Yes.
Okay. Angela, to your question, and this is which I picked up from the audience, is that India's inherent caste system, and that caste pollution has something to do with the fact that we believe that some people, that the Dalits, for example, whom Mahatma Gandhi used to call Harijans, and we consider them unclean. And it's only a couple of generations ago, where in Maharashtra, that even if the shadow of a Dalit fell on you, you would have to go wash yourself and bathe yourself. Yeah. Do you think that India has to deal with that too?
Yeah, it's actually fundamental. First of all, to Gurcharan's point and the other point, you have to remember that there is legislation in London against littering, and that's why people don't litter. And in Singapore, there's actually very severe penalties, even for dropping chewing gum. So I think that has a quite profound effect on how people behave, and that's a government responsibility, you know, for dealing with that. But on the caste issue, so there was a book recently written looking at, I think it was just titled Where Do Indians Go or something like that. Yeah.
Yeah,
where India goes. So the issue this raised was they did a survey of where latrines were installed. So the government has obviously a big program of installing latrines in areas where there are no latrines, and people aren't using them. And the question is why? Given that you have this resource, it helps improve hygiene and cleanliness, why are you not using the loos? And the answer is, well, there's a number of answers. One is that people, firstly, don't want a toilet inside their house because they think that this is an impure thing to have inside their house, number one. Not everybody, but in the communities where this is being introduced. And secondly, there's no one to clean them because India as a society has assigned this group to cleaning, you know, all the rubbish and toilet and feces. And if they're not available, if you say live in a remote community where you don't have enough of those people, the costs of removing this rubbish can run into thousands of rupees every time. So they literally cannot afford to clean these latrines.
So this shame that we associated with manual scavenging, for example.
Well, the question is fundamental, really, if you think about it. So I'm writing this book on race, and quite quickly, the issue came back to India. So I'm a science journalist, and I come from it from a scientist perspective. Why is India such an interesting case when it comes to race? It's because essentially the caste system is a racial hierarchy. It's a system that for hundreds of years has confined people to certain roles and groups in society. Now, how can you have a common civic sense in a society in which you have already decided not everybody is equal? Mm-hmm. You can't.
So does that mean that Prime Minister Narendra Modi's movement is bound to fail, Gurcharan?
No, I think, you know, I'm sorry, but
Angela.
I, just as I disagreed with the person on the floor, I feel that we should look at how countries have changed. Mm-hmm. And Singapore comes to mind. We think, oh, but Singapore is just a city. No, it's the principles that Singapore followed that made it change. And so,
but do we want to be Singapore? I mean, that's
yeah,
the question.
Yeah, but that's not the
does India want to be Singapore? I'm sure that you fine somebody for throwing chewing gum on the street, and that's a good thing.
It's not just fining. I'm sorry. There are a lot of other ways that they worked. Uh-huh. She talked about schools. They worked through schools. The basic idea that is the issue that don't think this is a cultural problem. That's what you're talking about. It's a cultural problem. Cultures take thousands of years to change. That's not right.
Okay.
All I was trying to illustrate that if you think that in 5 hours you get to Singapore and your culture has changed because you're behaving differently, it shows that governance has changed. And therefore, you made a very good point about municipalities. Now, in India, you go to a municipality, and what do you see? You see a municipal office, you see clerks. What you should see in a municipality are engineers. You should see sanitation engineers.
So does it mean governance has failed? Is that what you're talking about?
Exactly. What I'm saying is that Mr. Modi's
ideas are great.
Is a combination of how successfully we can change governance, mm-hmm. attitudes. Schools will immediately adopt these new ways,
yes,
etc.
Absolutely.
But ultimately, I think, you know, for example, this issue of solid waste.
Right.
Solid waste is a question of separation.
So now, share one thing with the audience.
Okay.
It's very interesting. You see, Gandhiji set the biggest example of mindset change. You know, there is a community called Vankar, weavers, you know, mm-hmm. who are called Bunkars in Gujarat. They are untouchables. You know.
So they still call them untouchables.
The kind of work Gandhiji did in Gujarat from Sarbanti Ashram. Mm-hmm. Today, Vankar was. The Vankar locality is one of the cleanest amongst the poor people.
Right.
In Gujarat. So it is possible to achieve this target, you know. Mm-hmm. If you go in a planned manner, I think just awareness is not enough. There has to be a concerted effort. Idea is there before us, you know. Mm-hmm. And in municipalities, the biggest problem is the elected body of the municipality is very weak and very corrupt.
Can I just say one thing? Yeah. I think your point is really sharp, which is a lot of this is about rule of law. You need to use a stick, you know, carrot and a stick, but you need to use a stick. You need to have some punishments for people who violate these littering laws and waste disposal laws. And so many things, just as a new person in India observing, like the rule of law here is much weaker than I expected. Yeah. And I came from sub-Saharan Africa, which is one of the poorest parts of the world. And in many of these areas, the rule of law is stronger. And you look at a place like Rwanda. Rwanda is one of the poorest countries on earth. They have a very strict policy against plastic bags. You come into Rwanda, you know, on foot, crossing in the country from, let's say, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and these border guards search your bag and take out any plastic bag.
Well, we know,
and people
yeah.
live in fear of violating these rules. And until you have that, you know, and that's what your point is. You get off a plane, and the reason why you don't dump something out the window when you arrive in London is because you're afraid you're going to get in trouble, or that people don't do
or
that.
Or in Singapore.
Or in Singapore. But the reason why people don't do that is because they know it's against the law, and there will be consequences.
Right. So, no, so we know that the, we know that,
plastics.
Yeah. So we know
plastic,
that the rule of...
So don't blame culture.
Right, okay. Well, but I think culture has, there is something,
you,
there
you
is something
about...
You can change
culture in 5 hours.
And rule of law, yes, we do have a weak rule of law, weak law and order. We know what's going on in Rajasthan, for example, on the whole Padmavat movie, but we won't get into that. But my question to you, Uday, somebody who knows Prime Minister Modi well, one of the criticisms of the Swachh Bharat movement was that the Prime Minister was trying to take away one sort of aspect of governance or of politics that the Congress Party was pushing. Now, it was, after all, Mahatma Gandhi's cleanliness sort of whole system that the Congress, that because the Congress felt that the Mahatma Gandhi belonged to them. Now, do you feel that the Prime Minister was politicizing the Swachh Bharat movement as well?
I don't think so. I mean, Prime Minister is an out-and-out politician. Nobody can deny it.
So he was politicizing
but
it?
But there are times when he is apolitical.
Apolitical.
I suppose when he floated the Swachh Bharat idea to Gandhiji's name, you know, I think he was, it was an apolitical move. I don't think there are any politics behind it.
I see.
Well, can I make one observation? Because
sure.
I wrote about this issue, and one thing that we found was many toilets had been built, but they hadn't been connected. Mm-hmm. And that there was this rush by the local officials to show progress because they have these websites that show, you know, how many villages are going to be open defecation free. And there's this eagerness to prove yourself in front of the central government because this is such a high priority project. And these toilets weren't connected. So you have these latrines to nowhere. Nobody's using them.
Yeah.
They're being registered as progress and they're not really changing the situation.
So latrines to nowhere, Gurcharan,
yeah.
Why is it that the BJP government, they are in 19 states, they're in power in 19 states,
right,
across the country, but they seem to have forgotten,
yeah,
about Swachh Bharat, more or less.
Absolutely.
So what is the problem with that?
I think, you know, we overestimated the power of Mr. Modi to implement when we elected him. The job of a prime minister is somewhat different from a job of a chief minister. A chief minister is a CEO, and he gives an order, and things happen.
So
a prime minister cannot give that kind
so
of
So why
order.
Did the prime minister get into this in the first place?
No, so it's very good he got into this.
Okay.
Because it's aspirational. And where now the job is to make sure that the municipalities are equipped with sanitary engineers, with ways to dispose of waste, with separating waste. And you know, the all the talk about caste and culture and all, I think is taking attention away from the real question of implementation. It's taking away the question that if you have proper governance,
yeah, right,
you
so
will
governance,
get results.
I think we cannot
and that's
ignore.
Where he has failed.
Yeah, well, we cannot
and
ignore.
And the BJP has failed in that.
Has the BJP failed in taking this movement forward?
It could have played a bigger role.
Okay.
And I think the biggest challenge.
But you're
challenge
not going
is,
to say it's failed.
The biggest challenge is to change the mindset of the state governments.
Right.
And today, I think 18.
Or 19 states.
In 19
yeah.
states, in BJP, they have to change the mindset of the state governments. You know?
Okay. So
and state governments, then next step is municipal bodies. You know?
Right. Sorry, so let me. Yes, Angela.
I was just going to say that caste is actually central to the question of implementation, because if you don't have the people available who are willing to do the jobs of cleaning, then how do you implement a policy? If you're already requisitioned a certain strata of society to do it, and they're not available
yeah.
in a certain community, then how do you implement
well,
a policy?
I, you know, I think that's really defeatism.
Because
what you're saying
the caste
is,
system.
Yet you are a victim of a caste system, therefore you cannot change.
No, because
no.
the caste system can change. You can overcome the system.
Right, so
caste.
But the issue is, look, there's a traffic light outside my house. and it's a pedestrian.
I think you're both talking about similar things. The point is that why is it that today's cleaners, whether it's scavengers or just people who clean our public toilets, and we know that they're in terrible shape, why is it that A, we cannot clean them? One of it is lack of implementation. But the other is that they all seem to belong to the lowest castes in society. Yeah. So that's something that we need to deal with. But I'm going to open this discussion to the House. Yes, go ahead. I think we have time for about 4 or 5 questions. A quick question, please. Yeah.
My first question to you, sir, that to Uday, sir, that on one hand we have example of Surat. So can you just elaborate about how Surat changed from a plague city to a cleanest city? On number point two, I'll give you the example of Karoli, that educated people, the Manuvad mentality is coming between to use the toilets. So how we are going to deal with that? Because as it is a mutual problem, both caste and governance.
Surat, excellent example.
Surat was a one-man job actually.
Yeah.
It was a missionary zeal of S.R. Rao.
And which it is turned a Surat governance.
Governance. Naturally, governance.
Okay. And Surat was a filthy
had,
place.
As Jeffrey said, he had put very stiff fines for littering, you know.
Right.
So it was, he
is
that
an
one
IS
can
officer.
Do it.
He's an IS
bureaucrats, officer. Bureaucrats, you know, here comes the question of mindset change on bureaucrats. S.R. Rao was driven by missionary zeal to clean up Surat, and he achieved it, you know.
And what about the, Angela, would you like to respond to the second part of the question?
So this was on why people aren't using...
On Manuvad, is that your question? Can you just ask your question again, please?
I didn't hear it.
So some castes...
In the house is unacceptable.
Some castes...
So how did Surat do it?
So some castes have this mentality of Manuvad, which is that the upper castes cannot clean. How is it that despite this, Surat was able to change?
I don't know about that particular example. I don't know how they managed to overcome it in that respect. But it really speaks, if they have managed to overcome it, it really speaks of the ability to overcome a cultural issue. I mean, what Gurcharan was saying was that we can't overcome culture, it's fixed and we can't do anything about it. Well, that's not true, actually. Cultures do change, and sometimes they change very quickly.
Yes.
So if it's possible there, then surely it's possible.
There's a place called Magarpatta in Pune.
Okay.
Go to Magarpatta in Pune, and you feel that you are in, my God, a dream world, not a spot. Nothing dirty on the street. It's the same Pune, and it works.
Okay.
But can I just interject here?
Yes.
Because I think it's a combination of governance plus individual responsibility. You know, if we say that we are going to do this, if each one of us says we're going to take care of not just our house, but everywhere that we go, we have a responsibility for this, and this is collective action.
Okay. So the lady, she was one of the first to raise her hands. Yeah. A quick question, please.
Thank you. My question is, and also a comment to make, a quick one, that I think it's easier for us, especially when we are, say, from the dominant caste, to interrogate our own positions and say that the caste doesn't matter. Caste does matter. I work with the rural elected women in the villages. And where the Swachh Bharat mission is concerned, my question to the panel is, to what extent do means justify the end? So for instance, in Rajasthan, they have a disqualification clause if you're going to contest local village council elections, that you need to have toilets in your house. We've seen what Jeffrey was also mentioning, that the toilets were built overnight and they were not using it, but it was just a target that needed to be met. Similarly, in Bihar, the government was trying to introduce the toilet disqualification clause, but they could not, because how do you expect when 65% of the people don't own land there?
Right.
Right? So till what point do you keep justifying it in a, like a mission? Everything becomes a mission in our country.
Thank you.
But how do you justify it?
So the question, if some of you got the question, was that in Rajasthan, for example, you must have a toilet in the house to contest an election. In Bihar, they tried to apply that, but it didn't work, so they dropped the condition. Now, does this mission, so we have a mission, Swachh Bharat, but do the means justify the ends? Do you have an answer to that? Why is it that we have this condition ki har ghar ke andar ek toilet hona chahiye tabhi hum election contest kar sakte hain?
I mean, I think Anandiben did it in Gujarat also at some level. You know.
Okay.
And it works. Uh-huh. It works. At,
so you think
in
that
Bihar we have to go into the merits as to what happened in Bihar.
Okay.
But it does work, you know.
All right.
I mean, as Jeffrey said, that there has to be some danda somewhere, you know.
Okay. But this is a bit too strong a danda. Bit too strong. You can't disqualify people from voting. That's, I think, going too far.
From standing for an election.
Yes, that's going too far.
So the question is, who's going to decide what those conditions are?
Yes. So therefore, I think there's a lot to learn from the rest of the world, and you have it's a question as Jeffrey said, it's a question of a carrot and a stick.
Mm-hmm.
Both need to work together. To make it happen, and of course, the culture will change very fast.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think
very
one
brief,
of the,
please, very yes, brief. You're short on
of,
time.
Yes, thank you so much. One of the major, most important things is why aren't our toilets getting cleaned? Why aren't we using those toilets? The problem is water.
Just take a couple of questions. Why are the toilets still not clean? Yes, go ahead and ask your question. We're completely out of time. No, this young boy at the back. Yeah.
मेरा क्वेश्चन है कि दो दिन पहले WHO की रिपोर्ट आई है. एयर क्वालिटी ऑफ इंडिया सबसे बैड है आफ्टर आउट ऑफ 180 कंट्री तो अपना रैंकिंग 178 है.
अच्छा.
बस हमारे नीचे एक तो कांगो है एक बांग्लादेश है.
ओके.
स्वच्छ भारत अगर कचरा उठाने से ही भारत स्वच्छ होता है तो वो कौन सा स्वच्छ भारत है जहाँ पे आपको ऑक्सीजन भी क्लीन नहीं मिल पा रही है.
So the question is that in this international report, out of 180 countries, India was 178. So despite the Swachh Bharat movement for 3 years, India still remains very, very low on these international indicators.
Yeah, and I guess we've talked about this, that the implementation, and especially at the level of the municipality.
Okay.
Empowering municipalities.
One child in front. Okay, one child. Come on. Yay, come on. Stand up and ask your question.
Okay, so like culture and caste keep being like brought up. And culture and caste keep being brought up. But could you please expand on that? Because we don't really understand how the caste system has anything to do with why India is like dirty.
Angela?
For the last few months, I've been kind of immersed in understanding how race works throughout the world. So racism, the idea of race, was actually a European invention 200-300 years ago. Before that, people thought about class, people thought about geography, tribes, that kind of thing, communities, but not really about race. Now, race scientists for hundreds of years have been fascinated by India. For what reason? Because India is, and this is what Indian geneticists actually pointed out in the 1950s, is a unique experiment where communities have been kept apart and they marry within those communities. It's like a racial hierarchy. Each group has been assigned their role in society and they're expected over generations to fit inside that role. There is very often very little hope of social mobility between those roles. Now, those are the very bottom of that hierarchy.
I think our time is up. Maybe you can explain how.
Yeah, you should just finish your sentence.
Yeah. Very quickly. So
we have 10 minutes for the next session to turn around.
Yeah.
Those at the very bottom are the ones expected to do the cleaning. You know, cleaning feces, cleaning, do the dirtiest jobs, and nobody at the top will do them.
Right.
So the question is, until every single one of us here is willing to clean our own toilet, I don't think we'll see real...
Okay, so let's take back this promise from here. Thank you so much to my panel, Hema, Angela, Gurcharan, Uday, and Jeffrey. Thank you.
Good.
A big round of applause for our panelists. Thank you so much. I'm sorry we couldn't take much questions, but it's just that we have to turn around for the next session. But actually, the response...